Hey everyone, so this is Devin T. Molina. He's an assistant professor from the Social Science Department at the Bronx Community College, which is here.
Thank you.
You're
welcome. Good morning, everybody. So I'm going to be talking about an activity that I've adapted for use in my sociology classes, particularly in the introduction to sociology, although it can be used in other sociology classes, anthropology classes, and other social science classes. So when teaching about sociology and helping students understand the dimensions, causes, explanations, and options for addressing various forms of inequality is one of the most important, if not the central, components of the sociology curriculum, and certainly central to how I teach sociology. And also understanding Karl Marx's theories of social inequality is also sort of central. And so this activity that I've designed is aimed at doing three things, really, and I'll talk a little more about that in a little bit, but really to help students understand the real-world dimensions of economic social inequality, as well as the barriers to social mobility, especially upward social mobility in the current economic and political climate, as well as using Karl Marx's theories of social inequality and stratification to help us understand the causes and consequences of inequality and the lack of social mobility. And this is, so teaching about social inequality at Bronx Community College and at similar institutions poses its own set of challenges. There's been a lot of research done on the challenges of teaching social inequality in higher education. But one of the specific challenges of teaching our student population, and I think that when I say our, I include not just Bronx Community College, but also Post Oak, even and other community campuses, especially at the community college level, is that our students are intimately aware, in ways that other students may not be, of various forms of social inequality, right? I've had students who are homeless, who are jobless, or who are trying to hold down three part-time jobs at the same time as taking care of children and sick parents and what have you. So they have a very visceral understanding of social inequality. But what they might lack is understanding how their experience of inequality is actually structured not by their own individual choices, but actually by broader social forces. All right, and so this game is aimed at helping them make those connections. All right, and there's been a lot of research that's been done on active learning strategies and their effectiveness of getting students helping students understand complex and abstract understanding, and especially understanding the sort of more structural forces that are at play at any given time, right? So some of the things that active learning does for students is it asks them to put themselves into a world, a simulated scenario, right? So, and it's a better way of helping them understand and make sense of things that are going on in the world that they otherwise could not do for various reasons. It also helps the students make connections between their own lived experience and what goes on with other groups of people as well as in the world on an everyday basis. It can also democratize the classroom. It gives students an opportunity to take ownership of their own learning as opposed to just being passive learners doing what you all are doing right now. The other thing is research has shown that it improves student responses. And I'll talk a little bit about the impact this game on that. And then finally, it can reduce prejudice and increase self-reflection. When students are able to put themselves in the shoes or into a real-life scenario, they're able to examine it from a much more, oddly enough, objective perspective and understand how their own, you know, biases and thoughts might color the way they think about these things on an everyday basis. Now, gaming and simulation as one active learning strategy can be particularly effective in helping students make these kinds of connections. Learning this sort of direct experience, you are embodying something. You're using not just your ears, but also your body. So it's a very kinesthetic activity. It can be a very kinesthetic experience. And that can help students understand complicated ideas. Simulation can further help students understand critical theory, which is really often a challenge. And it's certainly a challenge in sociology classrooms. And then finally, it can help students understand how social structure shapes individual opportunities, right? Which is really important when you're talking about something like social inequality. Okay. I'm going to talk about the activity and some of the results in a minute, but let me share with you what I was trying to do when designing this activity. Now, I should say that I'm not a genius. I didn't come up with this idea all on my own one day in the bathtub, right? A colleague of mine at Brooklyn College, Lawrence Johnson, told me that he does this activity, and that inspired me to start using it in my own classrooms. And so what I did is I took that idea and I sort of ran with it. So all of the gameplay rules and the intricacies of the game and activity, as well as the assignment that follows in the activity, are all of my own design, but he certainly inspired it. And I'm not the first person to think about using Monopoly in this way, and there have been plenty of people who use Monopoly to talk about a variety of different sociological concepts, but also economic concepts, accounting concepts, mathematical concepts, and so on and so forth. Okay, so what I wanted to do for this activity is I wanted to I wanted to help students understand the dimensions of income and wealth inequality in the United States. All right. So what I had, and then also identify the differences between equality of opportunity, condition, and outcome, and how they apply to U.S. society. And then finally, apply Karl Marx's theory of social inequality to the game and to real life. Now, in this presentation, I'm going to focus on the first and the last outcome. Just for time's sake, and because they are more closely related to each other. Excuse me. Okay, so let's talk about the activity itself, okay? So what I did was I basically had the students play, or what I do is I have students play a modified version of the household game Monopoly, okay? How many people here have ever played Monopoly? Right, almost everybody. Now, you would be surprised, maybe not surprised, to learn that many of the students that have taken my class and participated in this activity have actually never played the game. Students who are immigrants may not have ever played the game, but also there are many students who are native-born U.S. citizens who have also never played this game. So in preparation for the activity, I have the students do a number of things. All right. The first thing that I have the students do prior to us meeting for that class activity is I have them play a version of the Monopoly game online, okay? This Monopoly game has standard rules, and so it gives the students an introduction into how the game is played. This is helpful not only to those students who have never played the game before, but also to those students who are actually familiar with the game, because I'm sure every one of you in this room who played the game, none of you play the game right, or at least very few do. Most of us play with quote-unquote house rules, and I use a modified version of the game, but the gameplay rules are standard Monopoly rules, okay? And so I want the students to know those standard Monopoly rules, like what happens on a turn, what happens when you land here or there, like how do you purchase property, what's the goal of the game, et cetera, okay? And then the other thing that I have the students do is I have them read a chapter from a textbook, a sociology textbook, about social inequality. And in that chapter, they learn about the dimensions of social inequality, the causes and consequences of social inequality, as well as various theories about social inequality, like what causes social inequality, why is that important, all those other things, including Karl Marx's theories, as well as discussions of social mobility, right? So reading that text and then playing the game online prepares them for participating in the activity, the discussion that follows, and then the paper assignment that I give them after our discussion, okay? The activity itself, it takes place over the course of typically a 2-week period. 1 week where we meet to play the game, the next meeting where we discuss the game, and then the following where they write an essay about their experience and then connecting it to sociological concepts, as well as real-world inequality. Okay, so then the next stage, as I said, is the activity stage. The students play a game in groups of 4 to 8 players. I found that the most effective groupings are around 6, because as you'll see, the players are stratified economically. And so if you have 4 students, you typically have only 1 student in each of the economic categories. If you have 8 students, you have the broadest variety, but it can slow the game down a lot. And so what you end up having in one class period is the students get to play like a couple of rounds, right? As opposed to with 6 players, they get a lot of rounds where they get to play, and so it can broaden their experience, but also there's a good variety in stratification in the game. After the activity, the next class period, so I do the activity for an entire class period, and then we have a discussion in the following period where we make the connections between the game, the activity itself, as well as the reading that we had, that the student assigned, right? And in that discussion, we connect the activity to the reading as well as to what's going on in the world around them, and also to their own personal experience outside of the classroom. Okay. And then finally, I assign a paper, right? It's a 3 to 4 page paper that uses the game to explain real world social inequality, the trends related to social mobility, and uses Marxist theories or the Marxist perspective to make sense of what happened in the game and what happens in the real world, right? So the paper is a way for them to get their thoughts out and to think critically about the experience in the game and how it connects to real life. So that's the activity. Let me talk a little bit about the rules. So what does the activity actually look like? All right. The students receive income that replicates current U.S. income inequality, right? Now, I make this determination. There's basically, if you want to sort of classify this in terms of classes, there's basically 3 classes, okay? We have the upper class or the wealthy, you have the middle class, and then you have the working class and poor, okay? Calculate the starting income or the starting money that these students have, these players have, I start with $1,500 as the upper limit. So $1,500 is the median income of the top quintile of U.S. population. Okay, so top 20%. And then from that, so these two right here occupy the top quintile, right? And then you have the remaining 4 quintiles below that. And again, I just use $1,500 as the upper limit, and then these are sort of ratios, right? They're calculated as ratios. And so this would be the top quintile, the median income of the top quintile, and this would be the median income of the bottom quintile, and so on. Make sense? Okay. And in addition to a starting amount of money, students also get some of the players also get different properties. All right. So again, to reflect wealth inequality, and it's not as exact. There's no real way to calculate. To make a one-to-one calculation between wealth inequality with the monopoly setup in the way you can with the money. But what I did is basically I assigned the most valuable properties to the top 2 and also gave them ownership over the means of production, so the utility companies and the transportation network, the railroads, okay? And then the middle class, I'll get one property, and the bottom 2 quintiles don't get any. Okay? So the gameplay, as I said before, uses standard monopoly rules. The top income gets to go first. If there are 2 players in the top income groups, then they roll the dice to see who goes first, and then play continues clockwise, in a clockwise manner. Each player rolls a dice, right? I don't need to go into this. I mean, you all play monopoly. Know that the one thing is most people don't play with the auction rule, which is the standard rule. So if a player lands on a property and elects not to buy that property, then it goes up for auction and anybody in the game can bid, including the player who elected not to buy it in the first place. And so what you end up seeing is particularly savvy players, especially the wealthy players who are really savvy, what they will do is they will land on a property and then not buy it. It goes up for auction, and they get to buy it for half the amount because the lower income players can't afford to buy it, right? So this accommodates the accumulation of wealth amongst the top 20% at the expense of everybody else, okay? The other thing that I find in the game is you'll notice that when people land in jail, right, either they pick a card, or they land and go to jail, or they roll doubles three times in a row, they have to go to jail, all right? If you are a poor student, this is great for you because you get to play the game longer, which is really kind of obscene and interesting thing to think about and consider and see if there's an application in the real world for that kind of strategy, okay? In addition to the starting, right, whenever you pass go in the traditional game, you collect $200, right? Well, in this version of the game, it's based on your class status, right? So your income is going to be higher if you're higher. Now, in this one, unlike the starting values, I use $200 as the standard and then calculate from there. Only because if I made this, the $200, the highest income level, then this bottom category would get something like $7 each time they pass go, right? Which I couldn't do that. So. Honestly speaking, these folks, the race car and the dog, they're not going to get to go anyway. By the time they even have a chance to get that far on the game board, they've already lost. But at least I had to give them something, right? So that was my choice there. Okay. So I start the game by going over the rules. I find that going over the rules at the start of the activity is really helpful to the students because, as I said before, some students have never played before, and even playing online, they may have not fully captured the understanding of the game. But also because there are, I've changed the setup a little bit, I think it's helpful. It prevents me from having to go from group to group all game long and answer questions. Same question over and over again, right? And then I start the game with these instructions. Quote, you are a budding capitalist in the great republic of Monopolia. We live in a capitalist utopia. Taxes are low and the opportunities are plenty. However, like any other capitalist society, where you start in life often has a large role in where you finish. Your goal is to bankrupt all of your competitors by buying as much property and earning as much rent as possible. If all of your opponents have lost all of their money and property, then you win. But if you lose all of your money and property, you are bankrupt and you lose. Good luck. Okay. And so, as I said before, what inevitably happens is the poorer students will go bankrupt, even as early as their first turn. If you're familiar with the Monopoly board game and the board, and you can think about it, there's an income tax space right on the first row, right in the middle, right? And if a poor student lands on that, they don't have enough money to pay that income tax. It's a flat rate, right? Which gives you an opportunity to talk about taxation policy and the difference between regressive and progressive taxation. During the 2012 presidential race, when you had Herman Cain's tax policies, right, and then you had Rick Perry's tax policy, these were both flat tax policies. This game allowed us to talk about those kinds of things, right, and their impact on social mobility and inequality. Okay, some of the middle class students will end up staying in the game either forever or for a really long time, but they're barely hanging on. And then, of course, the wealthiest students do really, really well. Okay, so the students play the game, and then in the following class period, we have a robust discussion about the game and connect it to some of the concepts of social inequality, social mobility, and Marxist theories as well. Okay, and these are some of the questions that I ask, right? Why did some players win or lose? Was it because they're just really skilled, or they were really terrible at the game? And of course, as the students know, no, absolutely not. This is an unfair game, right? people won because they started off with an obscene amount of money and property, and people lost because they didn't. I often feel many complaints about unfairness. Some students say, well, I hated this game because I was out right away. Other students say, I love this game because I had everything, right? Interestingly, some of the wealthy students, right, the quote-unquote wealthy students, felt bad for winning, right? But importantly, that didn't stop them from playing the game, right? This question of unfairness and skill allowed us really to talk about some of Marx's theories of inequality in a really helpful and effective way. Another thing that I found that I'll often find is that the wealthy group students will collude with one another. They'll agree, sort of, not even like explicitly, but if they land on a property, right, and they choose not to buy it, but if we're allowed to go for auction, the other wealthy player will not bid on that property. They'll let the wealthy player buy that property for, like, say it's valued at $300, they'll buy it for $50 or $25, and they won't bid on it, right? That happens often. What you will not see is the sort of opposite happening, which is the middle class or poorer groups allowing each other to bid on a property without competition, right? And so it allows us to talk about class consciousness in Marx's theories of class consciousness. It's a good example of how, according to Marx, the wealthy have a well-established class consciousness, but the poor or the proletariat or working class do not, right? So it allows us to talk about that. The other thing I ask is this a realistic game? And many students will say, yes, of course it's realistic. And then this gives an opportunity to show just how realistic. So I talk about how I calculate the money, I connect it to actual data about income and wealth inequality, so the students get the actual data and evidence that supports that conclusion. And then finally I ask the question, if the game was unfair, why did you play it? And why didn't the poor, if the wealthy people were working together, why didn't the poor work together, right? And what would that look like? And so what ends up happening is the students say, well, I don't know that I could do that, I didn't know I could do that, or they wanted to win, right? And so this gives us an opportunity to talk about ideology and the power of ideology. Again, talking using Marx's theory. Thank you. Okay. So this is just really basic, some basic, you know, statistics that I gathered just from one set of papers from this activity last semester, okay? And this is just pulled right from their papers, okay? So as you can see, everybody was able to define social, thank you, social inequality. Now, I'm not measuring how accurate that definition is, but they gave one, right? I can say that most of them were fairly accurate, if not completely accurate. All the students were able to, 78% were able to define social mobility, and almost roughly two-thirds were able to define Marx's theories, right? So they also were able to, a large number of students were able to apply those theories of the game, and then to analyze it, to connect it to real life, okay? This one, for example, 96% of the students actually used real-world scenarios and compared them to the game, right? Which I thought was really impressive, okay? I'm running out of time, so I just want to very quickly, these are just a couple of examples that I pulled. Of course, these are the best examples that I pulled. There are some that are not so good. So what are some of the takeaways? So the activity, I think, is pretty good at getting the students to connect the game, their experience, to the theory. It gives the opportunity to students to better understand these really complex ideas. It can help them understand what's going on in the world as well as their own experience. Some of the limitations is that the simulation is not perfect, right? It doesn't account for public assistance, right? Welfare, those types of things. It doesn't account for other forms of social inequality. And then finally, I haven't figured out a way to do this in online classes, which is a big problem, right? The last thing, I know I'm out of time, but the last thing I want to say is one of the best things about this activity is that, I know we've all had the classes where you're just not connecting with your students, right? A little bit of a dud, you haven't built a rapport, right? Students just feel like they'd rather be anywhere else. We play this game, and the activity, the environment, the changes completely. Right, from that point forward, the students are plugged in, And it gives the students an opportunity to like go back. It's such a memorable moment that I can connect it to all kinds of things. I've used it in later classes to talk about deviance, talk about race. The students will notice that each token is the same across every game. We can talk about race and anyway. All right.
We completely out of time?
Yeah, okay. Sorry, I don't have time to field questions, but I'm happy to.